Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, thank you both for your service. Thank you also to your families for their backing of you and their sacrifice. It is greatly appreciated, and it does not go unnoticed. Let me just begin. I find it interesting that both of you have, or that you have identified General Selva in your opening comments or in response to the chairman, the list of where you see our greatest threats. And I'm just going to identify that in the new national military strategy, General Martin Dempsey, current chairman, describes the need to counter revisionist states that threaten international peace and security. The strategy identifies Russia, China, Iran, and North Korea as the four principal revisionist states. General Dempsey also writes that the U.S. military advantage has begun to erode and that future conflicts will come more rapidly, last longer, and take place on a more technically challenging battlefield. In which areas, General Selva, in which areas has the U.S. military advantage begun to erode, if you agree with his statement? And where would you recommend that the Department of Defense focus its investments in response to this erosion?
Senator, I think there are four principal areas where that erosion has started to take place. The first is space. Up until the turn of this decade, the United States had pretty much dominance in space. That's no longer true. Across the networks of cyberspace, we see intruders and nation states acting to counter our capability to provide the command and control for our military that gives us the speed of decision on the modern battlefield. And then it wouldn't be fair not to highlight the fact that our opponents and our potential adversaries are looking for asymmetries across our conventional and nuclear capabilities. And as they detect and act against those asymmetries, they erode the capability that we have within our current force structure to react to threats that might emerge. So I would place the four in about that order.
Okay. General McDew, you identified cyber as being an item of major concern. I agree with your assessment. I'm just curious, though, with regard to whether we're talking about policy or as we talk about statutory assistance, if you've looked at and you've begun the process, where do you see the most important statutory changes, if any, that DOD would be required to make recommendations with regard to cyber capabilities and operations? Are there specific statutes that you've identified yet in your review?
Senator, I have not had that level of depth to have specific statutes, but if confirmed, I will endeavor to do so.
General Selva?
Senator, the only area that as the Transportation Command commander that I looked for increasing capabilities is the ability, having looked into contract law and the imposition of specific requirements for reporting on intrusions, to work across the interagency to make sure that any location, any organization that received the notification of an intrusion into a commercial or a military network had an affirmative obligation to report that intrusion so that we could defend the networks that make us successful. That authority is tied up in a variety of statutes that prevent agencies from speaking to each other clearly across law enforcement and the military. Beyond that, I have not spent the time and effort yet to work with Admiral Rogers at Cyber Command to look at the broader national issue of cyber defense.
Okay. You identified as one of those four existential threats the country of Iran. In your view, is Iran still the leading state sponsor of terror?
Yes, sir, they are.
With the proposed nuclear treaty or nuclear agreement, which was announced this morning, if Iran is provided economic sanctions relief, do you believe Tehran would use some of these funds to enhance its military capabilities and its support for terrorist organizations?
Senator, I haven't yet had the opportunity to study the entire agreement, but on its face, what I've heard from the press, the immediate lifting of sanctions or the sequential lifting of sanctions will give Iran the access to more economic assets with which to sponsor state terrorism should they choose to do so. And I think we need to be alert to that possibility. And as the military, we have an obligation to provide the president with a full range of options to respond. So if confirmed, I look forward to working with the department to examine those issues more deeply.
How do you respond to any additional Iranian aggression that may be forthcoming with their additional capabilities for procuring weapons?
Senator, absent the actual context of that specific intervention and that specific sponsorship of terrorism or other malign activities, it's difficult for me to actually give you an answer to that question other than to say we need to have a range of available options with which to respond, whether it's militarily, diplomatically, economically, or otherwise.
But you clearly recognize that the additional threat would now exist.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.